So The Man in the High Castle takes place in 1962 in a world where the Allies have lost World War II. It's primarily set in the United States, and the eastern half of the country is occupied by the Nazis, the west coast by the Imperial Japanese, and there's a neutral zone running down the Rocky Mountains that's basically a lawless buffer zone between the two. Well, it's very unsettling because it makes you think, what if? You know, what if we'd lost? How different would things be? And you can't help thinking about the world you live in now and what's important to you. And that's why I love it, because it's about something. Like all the best science fiction, there are ideas that it's exploring, and I think they're incredibly relevant. You know, Philip K. Dick wrote this book over 50 years ago, but the themes of what it means to be human and how you keep your humanity in an inhuman world seem incredibly relevant.
I play Frank Frink, who lives on the west coast, occupied by the Imperial Japanese, and he's a man who's an artist, but in this world, sort of modern art, or as they call it, degenerate art, is you know, banned and highly regulated. And Frank Frink lives with his girlfriend Juliana Crane, and it's not until the events, until Juliana disappears and Frank gets taken in, that his whole life really gets turned upside down. He's a man who's trying to really just to kind of keep his head down in the first episode, trying to live a life as quietly and sort of unobtrusive as possible within this regime. And through events, you see his life unravel, and he becomes radicalized, really, in a way, and so you see this man changing from a sort of sensible young guy to something very, very different, and that's really the arc for him in the season.
I think Philip K. Dick wrote this as a parable for the Cold War between the United States and the Soviet Union. So, in this version of history, the Nazis are winning that Cold War. They're ahead of the Japanese, you know, economically and technologically. And of course, America's ground zero if there's another world war between these two empires. So that makes all of our characters quite uneasy. But it also makes you think about, you know, the different qualities of freedom, because the two societies are structured differently.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely. Within the Nazi, even on the East Coast, then, you know, I think there's a sense that The Nazi kind of government are trying to create a society where everyone is... They're trying to integrate, I think, aren't they? Where they're trying to integrate the society. Whereas in the Japanese side, where I live, there's a real definitive sort of hierarchy where, interestingly, in the book and in the series, the Americans are seen as the sort of lower class structure, really, and the Japanese are on top. So... it's a kind of direct flip on how America works now. Well, that was part of, you know, I think is it part of its appeal as an actor. You look for characters and stories that push the boundaries and ask big questions. And this certainly did. And when I received the script, it was actually 2 hours I received at the beginning. And with my character Frank Frink, he gets tortured very badly, and his life is never the same. And I found it both sort of incredibly hard work, and it's grueling. And I did a lot of, you know, research and looked at many films like Schindler's List and others to kind of give me a real sense of the persecution that others have gone through in the past. I think human beings are, when they're put into a kind of an extreme environment, we it's very, very weird how we react. And I think the series looks at different people's lives and puts them in very extreme situations. And that's what's interesting, I think, about the show. Who is he, Frank? Even I don't know.
Well, he's sort of like the Wizard of Oz. in the novel, The Man in the High Castle has written a book where the Allies won World War II. In the television series, we've changed that. In the television series, there's a film that shows the Allies winning World War II. And somehow The Man in the High Castle is connected to this film. And that's what you have to watch the show to find out. And really what The Man in the High Castle represents is hope for a different world, is hope for change, which, you know, endures even in a dark landscape like the landscape of The Man in the High Castle.
Everyone's really intrigued, I think. And, you know, it's... from my point of view, I think we would, you know, I'm incredibly indebted to Amazon. I'm sure you are as well, Frank, because I think this show is so big in its scope that no one else would really have taken it on. And I think it's fair to say that networks and, you know, certainly wouldn't have touched the subject matter. I think it's, you know, it's tricky and you've got Nazis and, you know, and there are, you know, people who are still alive who remember that. So I think Amazon are very, you know, brave, and they're looking for a very original content, a content that, you know, people who actually are really, you know, interested in watching, I hope, and it's not run-of-the-mill. So I and the way we watch it, you know, we're watching television very differently now, aren't we, you know? and on the 20th of November, when all 10 episodes drop, people... You know, people can watch it all in a day, which is very different to, you know, to how we used to watch TV. So it's exciting. I think it's, we'll see what the public say.
Yes, so I've co-created, and my company, Big Light Productions, is co-producing a series called Medici Masters of Florence with Richard Madden and Dustin Hoffman. And it's an ongoing series about the Medici, who were the Renaissance family that really changed Western civilization.
I've just, in fact, yesterday just wrapped on a film called American Pastoral, a Philip Roth novel, which is Ewan McGregor's first crack at directing. And so we've just finished that in Pittsburgh. And I play Jerry Lavave, which is Ewan's brother. Actually, Ewan is starring in it and is directing it for the first time with Jennifer Connelly. So that will be out sometime next year. And... And The Boy, which is a sort of a thriller, a sort of horror movie with Lauren Cohen, which is coming out on the 22nd of January. So, yeah, lots of running around.